In the next 5 short lectures, we will have a unique opportunity to hear the experience and the vision of 5 experts, all of them world authorities in their topics and past presidents of previous International Congress on SME. First of all, I would like to introduce the first speaker, Professor Marvin Fritzler. Professor Marvin Fritzler is Professor of Medicine at the University of Calgary, Alberta, Canada. He is the chair of the Alberta Research and Innovation Authority, and he was the first president, of course, of the first International Congress on SME in Calgary in 1986.
Share with you some ideas about what lies ahead in the future. As a beginning point, though, when the first Lucas Congress was held in Calgary, we had 180 attendees. In checking with Dr. Amigo, she tells me that we're somewhere plus minus 1,800 today. So 25 years or so after the first Congress in Calgary, Canada, to today, all of the senators have taken this way beyond anything that I would agree to. I'm only talking about 25 years. And for an older senior citizen like me, that doesn't seem so long. But what does seem long is the title that Dr. Amigo asked me to speak to, and that is, what will autoantibody testing be in the year 2050? As a background to my predictions and prophecy, if you will, I want to start here. At first glance, looking at zebras drinking at a pond in Central Africa, you might think that all zebras are alike, but they aren't. In fact, each one of the zebras in this photograph has its own unique pattern, its own unique fingerprint expressed on their surface. Not all zebras are alike. And if we look around this room, none of us are alike, as this illustration from Sports Illustrated shows the sports phenotypes. So each sport has its phenotype. You have to be preferably tall to play basketball. You have to be big like me to be a sumo wrestler, and so on. And so, to extend it to the topic of this conference, neither are all lupus patients alike, and most people know that. But I don't think today, in the year 2013, we get to put that in practice. It is illustrated even more that lupus patients aren't alike in this heat map of autoantibodies. And if we look at this serology of 100 pediatric patients from the hospital, for 6 children in Toronto, you'd be hard-pressed to find 2 pediatric lupus patients that have the identical autoantibody profile. We can subset them into those that have a DS DNA, chromatin phenotype or serotype, RNPSM, RORA, and then another subset that are ANA negative. But it does illustrate the point that the serology, like the phenotypes we see in the clinic, is also very heterogeneous. Ironically, one of the autoantibodies that ties these patients together, and it is for many systemic autoimmune rheumatic diseases, is antibodies to Rho 52 or TRIM21, shown here in blue box. All that to say, if we look at lupus patients, does it make sense that all lupus patients would be treated with the same medication? Or does it make sense that all patients with lupus have the same autoantibody profiles or genotypes or any of the omics as well? In my view, personalized medicine is part of the desired future, not only of lupus, but of many of the conditions that we are thinking about. Personalized medicine is often misunderstood as a one-to-one approach to the treatment of patients.
in the early 1950s, all the way through to technology wise and indirect influences. But the technology continues to move on. We have at our disposal today a wide selection of platform technologies that can detect autoantibodies in finer detail than we have ever had in the history of our study of lupus. So we can go all the way from Lyme immunoassays to arrays, addressable laser beams, all the way down to nanotechnology and nanobarcodes. In the latter case, the promise that with nanobarcodes we'll be able to detect 8,000 autoantibodies in a small pinprick of blood from a single patient. Do we need to detect 80,000 autoantibodies? Probably not, not unless we understand more. Where are we today? The technology has moved so much so that now I don't even have to sit in a microscope room to read my ANA immunofluorescent slides. Shown on the left is an automated ANA reader that picks up barcoded slides, identifies the patterns, and if I wanted today, I could pick up the results of the tests done in my lab today on my iPhone or any Android device. And it's there, I can check off, yes, this is the right result, it's the right result. And that result then goes directly into an electronic medical record in our city called Netcare. So even the area of indirect immunofluorescence has become much different than we've thought of it in the past. The technology that I referred to in the digital world, and whether it's an Android device or an iPhone, I think is only an example of where technology for ANAs is going. In the upper left-hand corner is a device that, if you hold to your chest, will do an electrocardiogram. A device just approved by the FDA in the United States about 3 months ago. On my own iPhone, I have a stethoscope. I don't need the old stethoscope anymore. I hold my iPhone to the patient's chest and can do heart sounds that way. Lab-on-a-chip technology, shown in the bottom right, is already with us. And using this technology is going to change. Who here has had their own genomic profile done? I don't see any hands. Well, I have, and my wife has. So what you see here is the genetic RFLP pattern of my wife on the left, and mine on the right. I know with relevant degree of confidence which diseases I'm at high risk from and which, based on the genetic profiles, I am not. Again, a part, I think, of the desired future of ANA testing that I'll come to why I'm here. And where are my risks? The device you see in the bottom right that tells me exactly how many steps I took today, what my current heart rate is, how many calories I burned today.
If you look at me in 3D,
you know it was a heck of a lot.
It doesn't work.
Even though I went wrong. But this device, if you have a neuropathic atrial fibrillation, because I do, can be life-saving. So the devices and the technology we have are increasing. There's one slide and one image that I think epitomizes why prediction is difficult is this. If you look along the bottom in 1990, the number of facts that we used to make a given diagnosis, let's say it was lupus, was relatively small. You could see 5 to 10 data points, physical findings, lab findings, went into the diagnosis. In 2000, it's gone up. But look what the prediction is. If you start adding in proteomics, RNAomics, metabolomics, metabolomics, epigenetics, functional genetics, so forth. The point of this is by year 2030, we can't even predict what we're going to have available in terms of the technology and the impact it has on clinical medicine. Part of this technology is going to be point-of-care diagnostics, which is the equivalent of the take-home pregnancy dipstick test. We already have beta versions of these that were tested, where the diagnosis or at least the identification of autoantibodies to DNA and other target antigens can be made quickly. I want to close with this painting by Bev Bulo. Bev Bulo is an American artist who paints images that have often embedded in them things you don't see at first. At first glance, your focus will likely be the red fox in the middle.
But if you focus on the red fox, you're going to miss images of a North American Indian here. Here's his head. Another one here. Here's the horse's head, and so on. Why am I pointing to that? That if we continue to focus on AMAs, that we will become myopic and our focus will be too narrow. Analytics will be the key, meaning genomics, proteomics, metabolomics, and metabolomics all in an integrated approach. And as Dr. Urowitz said last night at the Lupus Academy, don't forget to listen to the patients. So ANA in the year 2050, where will it be? I don't know. But I can tell you it's going to be very different than it is today. It's going to rely on analytics because we need to integrate everything. I want to last comment about the butterflies. When the first congress was held in Calgary, we chose the butterfly as a symbol of these congresses, not to represent the butterfly rash of lupus, but we were referring to the Greek mythology of Pandora's box and referred to the releasing of all the bad things that can happen when you have a diagnosis of lupus. But like in the myth of Pandora's box, the last thing that came out of the box was an iridescent creature with wings like a butterfly. That being the symbol of hope. And for patients here and for all of you who